I don't know what you want. If you're looking for ransom, I can tell you I don't have money. But what I do have are a particular set of skills.
Skills I've acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for
people like you. If you turn up now, that'll be the end of it.
I will not look for you. I will not pursue you.
All right.
But if you don't, I will look for you. I will find you. And I will kill you. So about 10 minutes then.
Okay. Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Arts Alive Film, coming from the Odeon, Liverpool One.
I'm Tony Lindsay.
And I'm Tony Lloyd.
Okay, on this week's show, we take a closer look at the Taken franchise starring Liam Neeson, before reviewing Taken 3.
And we'll also be talking to Liverpool filmmaker Ryan Kruger about his career so far.
Then, of course, we have our usual DVD roundup, before taking a look at the action genre.
Action, did you say?
Follow us.
Let's go.
Okay, well, this week sees the release of Taken 3, the third in the trilogy, which sees CIA operative Brian Mills, played by Liam Neeson, taking on all manner of baddies, all foreign, of course. Nice xenophobic streak in this series of films. So, Taken 2008.
Well, it came as a surprise to see thespian heavyweight Liam Neeson
more acting man than action man,
absolutely taking on a purely action role, which I think that was its uniqueness for the first one.
People were
intrigued, people wanted to get involved, have a look, and it was well directed. There was some good stuff with some great quotable classic lines.
Indeed, of course. Pierre Morel directs with the flourish. It was a bit die-hardy, but nobody minded that. Now, the thing about this film, it was headed for the DVD bargain basement until at the last minute it got a reprieve and suddenly found its audience. It took off in a big way.
Absolutely.
We had Maggie Grace on board as Liam's daughter, who gets kidnapped by Romanian people traffickers in Paris. Lovely
location.
And
that whole sequence is probably one of the most famous sequences.
It is now.
Where he name checks the actual title, doesn't he? He tells you, he has to tell his daughter she's about to be taken. And that is a great tense scene.
Yeah, indeed. It was very well directed. We had Famke Janssen on board as Neeson's estranged wife. Some
X
great
Bond
action
girl.
Sequence. Ex-Bond girl and ex-Marvel. X-Men.
Woman.
X-Woman, yeah.
Try saying that.
But it found its audience. It was hugely successful. But then it took how many years for...
Let's have a look. 4 years we got a sequel.
Before we got a sequel. Luc Besson, of course, the master of the action genre, wrote the first one. And it came on board again for the second one, as Tony says, 4 years later. And Liam comes along with Famke and his wife, Famke and his daughter, should I say, on holiday in Budapest now. But the relatives of the terrorists he's massacred in the first one are now seeking revenge.
They are not happy.
And in a kind of flip, it's Liam and his wife Famke who are taken this time, mm-hmm. and it's the daughter who must fend for herself. Of course, Liam
and help,
comes along
and
help.
And in effect, help her father.
And there are some clever scenes in this. There are. We've got a new director on board, strangely monikered Olivier Megaton. Who renamed himself after the Hiroshima bomb, because he was born on the
6th of August.
So
we're going to have to do that.
Maybe that tells us something about the talent behind the lens on this one. Okay, but same as usual, it was a lot of running, thrills, explosions, etc.
That's the difficulty with this film. You know, if you have a sort of a, say like a Dirty Harry franchise, you've got a policeman or a cop with different cases. This kind of has to be the same, isn't it? You know, Liam going after a certain bunch of people.
Yeah, and you've got Liam 4 years older in this one, and in some shots it does tell. His running isn't up to speed at times, is it?
No.
But he's great. Liam Neeson's always good value for money.
Yeah, I mean, he's always good to watch. And the film is fast, furious, as you would expect from a even though he didn't direct a Luc Besson film, wisecracking, well shot, fast edited. So if you're a fan of the action genre, obviously you're going to enjoy
and
this.
And that was supposedly it. Neeson said there was no chance of a third.
So what brought him back, pray tell?
Well, let's go and have a look, shall we? We'll go and take a view of Taken 3 in the IMAX, of course.
IMAX.
So, yeah, it. We'll see you there.
We'll see you there. So, Taken 3.
And here we are at IMAX again. Fantastic presentation. Okay, that's the presentation over. Let's get to the film. Taken 3. Well, we got Olivia Megaton back on board as the director. We got Luc Besson.
Can I just interrupt?
Indeed.
I think we should change our names.
Go
you
on.
You could be Tony TNT, and I'll be Tony Trident, if he's Olivia Megaton.
Okay. Talk to my agent.
I will.
Okay. So we got Luc Besson back on writing duties.
Yeah.
We've got Liam Neeson returning after declaring
war on the underworld.
War on the underworld. He declared last time that he wouldn't be returning after the end of Taken 2, but the studios offered him a cool $30 million, and here he is back again for Taken 3.
So what?
And boy, does it show.
Yeah. For all you action lovers, I mean, the formula's there, but that's where the rub lies, really, isn't it?
Yeah, I
it
mean, we're obviously preaching to the converted with the action fans, and I'm an action fan. I love
Me
the
too.
Die Hards and the Lethal Weapons and the
Born films.
But this, I think, it's just we see that it's just stretched itself a couple of films too far here.
Yeah, and I think the worst offence the film makes is it kind of makes out that. I mean, it really doesn't trust the intellect of an action audience. If you want to hear what the story is, you will get exposure to the limit.
Exposition. There are two scenes towards the end of the film where good guy meets bad, punch up, etc., etc. But the whole action is punctuated with literally exposition. He lands one punch onto the villain. Explanation.
Gets an answer.
Next punch. Question.
But
answer.
also within this sequence of action and fighting, there's flashbacks as well.
Yeah,
so,
absolutely.
So you've got everything layered, so you do not miss the story. And take it from me, you will have got the story relatively early.
Five times or six times over by the end credits.
Yeah.
You've also got the hark back to the 1930s and 1940s, what they call the old chapter serials, where there's a car crash and the car goes over the edge, rolls, explodes with our hero inside it. And, you know, I looked at Tony and said, how the hell is he going to get out of that? He gets out of that, but we don't know at the time. At the end sequence, when they're having the punch-up, we get a flashback and an explanation of how he got out. Structure-wise, this thing is all over the place, and it's juvenile.
I mean, there's a great action sequence. There's a great action sequence on a motorway, mayhem. So for all you action lovers, you know, I think the Taken formula is there if that's what you want.
Yeah.
But it is looking very tired now.
The rating. This again is a 12A, which Taken 2 was a 12A. Now, if you buy it on DVD, you'll find that there's a harder cut on there as well.
Yeah.
You can see this coming a mile away. They're going to do the same with Taken 3. There's violence in this, non-stop violence, but it's kind of, I wouldn't say restrained, but it's edited so that you don't get the full.
Yeah.
Blood.
There's a lot of fast editing and sound crunching, which gives that feel. So, what are we saying?
Well, the thing about they do the same that Die Hard did. When they got to Die Hard 3, they realised they had to up the game with the casting. They brought on Samuel L. Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
Here, they bring on Forrest Whitaker as the cop pursuing Neeson, and we get a kind of
cat and mouse
fugitive. There are certain references to the fugitive.
And what I found strange is Forrest Whitaker, who's a brilliant actor, seems to be reprising his FBI role from the Schwarzenegger film, The Last
Stand.
The Last Stand.
The Last, yeah. That's right, yeah.
Where he's this wise, very clever,
yeah,
talking him through.
But it was Tommy Lee Jones from The Fugitive as well, wasn't it? The super intelligent OCD, almost Sherlock Holmes brain at work.
Yeah.
And then you've got Doug Ray Scott playing Lenny's...
Lorna's husband.
Yeah, that's right, the ex, who suddenly is now... Well, let's just say a very different character in
very,
this.
Very, very different.
Very different character, yeah, in this.
Well, I reckon, clever audience, you'll suss that, you'll suss that one out quite early.
Yeah. But, okay, so in conclusion...
We're saying, if you love action, you will like it, but don't be expecting any...
big surprises.
Or surprises, yeah. No.
I'm going to finish this.
If you go down this road, the LAPD, the FBI, the CIA... They're all gonna come for you. They'll find you, and they'll stop you.
Good luck.
So that's it for part one. In part two, we'll be talking to Liverpool filmmaker Ryan Kruger.
And of course, we'll have our DVD reviews. So, see you after the break.
See you later. Hello and welcome back to part two.
Earlier this week, we invited independent filmmaker Ryan Kruger up here to the gallery at Odeon Liverpool One for a quick chat about his career. Tell us something about yourself, your background.
Well, originally from Wallasey on the Wirral. And I've 7 years ago made a trip to decide to go to South Africa and start trying to do my acting and directing out there. And then 7 years later, now back in Liverpool just for a holiday. But so I've just been in South Africa the whole time, shooting music videos and doing a lot of acting work.
And the whole concept of the music video is basically the hoax of the Mars landing. It's based on a 70s movie, Capricorn 1. So it's about the South African astronauts going up to space, first people ever to walk on the face of Mars. And what the astronauts don't know, last minute they've been pulled from the project, and they're actually cheating the whole thing in a studio, so they're actually not going to space, and the government, a conspiracy that they actually don't go to Mars, and they're basically being held there captive by the government.
So how easy is it to set up as a filmmaker in South Africa?
It's like everywhere else, really. It's just one of those things. Obviously the industry's a bit smaller over there, so I mean it's not as, you know, I mean you go to LA or something, you've got like a casting director's book which is like about this thick, and as an actor you'll probably never get to see all those, you know, casting directors. But in South Africa, you know, you're looking at about 10 to 15 major casting directors, or even a bit less, to be honest. So I mean, if you're an actor and you get to see all those casting directors, then you know you're in luck. So. Well, I do a lot of acting over there as well. But at the same time, I think everybody knows me as a director over there. But a lot of people say, oh, yeah, he's doing acting now as well. But I actually started acting like long before I went into directing. So it's just been one of those things. But I think the acting's always helped me with my directing and vice versa. And I think it's made me a better director and a better actor for that.
Well, I'm curious, Liam. How has it made you? How have they fed each other? How's it made it better?
I mean, it's one of those things. It's like if I'm directing you, I'm not going to leave you in the dark. I know exactly how you feel. So I mean, even me as an actor, sometimes, you know, I've been on set in a commercial, and then I've got the part, I've auditioned for it, but I'm standing there, and then you do get some of those directors that just won't speak to you. So they'll be like, okay, standing by, rolling, and you're standing there thinking, oh, what the hell do I do? You know, nobody spoke to me. So yeah, I think it's one of those things where, you know, I won't leave you in the dark. I'll speak to you. I'll go through it with you, because you know I've been on that side where, you know, where I'm thinking like, I hope I know where I'm going and I get the right direction that I need.
So was a particular genre you enjoy working in, Ryan?
I don't know, that's a really hard question that, because I mean, I like all genres. You know, you go to the cinema, you watch a comedy. I wouldn't necessarily shoot a comedy film, but I mean, you know, you sit there and you enjoy it. So, I like a lot of dark stuff, not necessarily, you know, that I love horrors. I do like horrors, but I mean, it's a thing that I've touched on now, and I think I've kind of done that. I want to go another way. And so, I mean, it's kind of like all Danny Boyle's movies are all very different from the next. You know, you got Sunshine, you got 28 Days Later. So I mean, they're all vary from the next. So.
And would you like to be that type of director where you can
I'd like to
fit into
exactly. Yeah. Well, even what I'm doing now, like with my directing for like music videos, I'm known for a narrative music video director, so I tell a lot of stories in music videos. But even the style that I do, I have my dark experimental style, and that's more me. And then I have the more commercial stuff that I do, and it's really good. It's not really my sort of stuff, but it's also to show that, you know, I'm not this one trick pony, and I can do this, and I can do this really well as well.
So do you see yourself as an auteur, or do you see yourself as an auteur and a journeyman director, a guy for hire?
I'd rather go my route of the stuff that I really like to do. Okay. But I mean, that even in that style, it varies as well. So I mean, I just don't want to I don't want to be known for doing lots of different styles.
But the more control for you.
I think more control for me. And I mean, when those, like a film that I want to do now this year, it's one of those things where I've had this idea for a while, and it came to me, and I actually wanted to make it a short. And then I was thinking, why do I want to make this a short? I should be making this a feature.
Okay.
So I mean, and it just feels right. So that right now, that's what I'm working on.
Ryan, thank you very much for coming on the show.
Really appreciate it.
Really nice meeting you.
Thank you
very much.
So obviously Ryan is someone to watch.
Oh, definitely a talent, indeedy.
Okay, so we're looking at DVDs, and this week we're looking at Before I Go to Sleep, the 2014 film starring Nicole Kidman.
Yeah.
What do you think?
A bit of a classy thriller, adapted from S.J. Watson's bestseller, of course, by Rowan Joffe. Now, I don't know if any of you out there remember Roland Joffe, he of The Killing Fields and The Mission, had some good connections to Liverpool, as I remember. Rowan, is he not in the same class as his dad?
This was a strange one for me. It reminded me. It's filmed and set in England, but it's a strange England. I think it served the story.
Yeah.
It's a bit of a sleeper. But it is a strange.
I like what you did there. A bit of a sleeper.
Do you like it?
It has its own visual identity, doesn't it?
Absolutely. Well, the story itself's intriguing. Nicole Kidman, each morning she wakes up, doesn't it? She
can't remember a thing.
She can't remember a thing. She's in a bed. Each day she wakes up, she's in bed with what she regards as a stranger, who then tells her that he's her husband. And 10 years previously, there was an accident and she had brain damage. So she has to learn each day. She has a doctor who rings her, but when her husband's out, and tells her to keep a camera diary so that she can remind herself each day of the progress that she's made. But all is not what it seems.
No, there are twists and turns every 10 minutes in this. It's pure Hitchcock, this one. I know we keep referring back to Hitchcock, but this does have a certain Hitchcock feel about it. Ben Davis's cinematography adds to that, the strange locations, as Tony pointed out earlier. What I like about this as well, Nicole Kidman isn't her usual icy queen.
No.
She emotes beautifully in this.
I mean, this is a woman who doesn't know what the hell's going on most of the time.
Reminded me of Memento.
Yeah, very much so. She's very, very broken, very vulnerable. And to keep that type of performance going consistently throughout
the
whole movie takes some doing. She's probably the strongest point in it, really.
Yeah. I mean, obviously she's got some good support from Colin Firth, Mark Strong, and
who she specifically asked to work
with when she came on board, wasn't
and he worked they worked on the Railway Man after this.
They worked on the Railway Man, yeah.
Anne-Marie Duff throws in an appearance as well, so yeah, good cast. As I say, it did remind me of Nolan's Memento a lot, the way she builds up the information with videotape and photographs. Whether it delivers as much as it promises, I'm not so sure.
No.
I came away feeling like it was a high quality piece, but I still felt I wasn't wholly satisfied.
Well, we spoke about this, didn't we? And I'd said sometimes when you in the 70s you'd see these double bills, and this may have been the film on before the main feature. Not that it's any less, but it has a strange feel, retro feel.
Yes, it does
for me.
Yeah,
and of course Ridley Scott.
Ridley Scott under the banner of Scott
Free. Produced. Apparently, he bought the rights to the book early on.
Yeah.
So yeah, well worth a look. I think if you like thrillers that keep you guessing,
this is one for you.
Absolutely. So that's it for this week.
Next week it's the women who take the lead duties. We have Reese Witherspoon in Wild, and of course Vera Brittain's Testaments of Youth.
I want to see that.
Indeed. See you then.
Take care. Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Art Alive Film, coming from London.
I'm in Liverpool.
How are you?
On today's show, we'll be looking at the Taken franchise. What's wrong?
You went. My name. Liverpool filmmaker, but South Africa based. So that's it for part one.
Sorry.